Okay, let's start then. Okay, I'm going to have to get, let's see, Marianne. Okay, good. Okay, let's just recap. We've assumed we're talking about Cooper-paired Fermi superfluids. We're talking about an even number of spin and half fermions, with one caution. Remember this rather awkward little point that because in the spin triplet case, there's only one k equals zero state. Okay. That can't be paired, so you've got to just singly occupy that state, and then you just subtract that guy off and count from there, as it were. Okay, but apart from that, you've got an even number of spin and half fermions in free space for the moment, and so the postulate is that the many-body ground state wave function can be written in the form, crudely speaking, of a number n over 2 of Cooper pairs, each of which is described and created by this operator here. That's the particle conserving formulation. Now, you can also use, and it's often more convenient to use, the BCS formulation, in which you don't talk about, in some sense, individual particles. You talk about the amplitudes for occupation of different states. And so you write your total wave function as a product over wave functions referring to pairs of states, k up minus k down. Well, k up minus k down if you're talking about singlet, or k up minus k up if you're talking about triplet. And in either case, the form of phi k is given by an expression of this type, so a quantum superposition of a state in which neither k up nor minus k whatever is occupied, and a state in which they're both occupied. And the relation between the ck, which occurs in this formula, and the vks and uks, which occur here, is this. Okay, let's for the moment, for definiteness, assume a spin singlet state, although everything in fact goes across to the spin triplet case rather easily. But just have something definite to talk about. Let's assume we're talking about spin singlet pairing. Then the state 1-1 is simply k up minus k down, both occupied. If you consider, however, the four-dimensional Hilbert space associated with these two states, k up and minus k down, then you have actually four possibilities. You've got the 0-0 state, 0-1, in which, for example, k up is unoccupied and minus k down is occupied. And then 1-0 and 1-1. So that means, since you have a four-dimensional Hilbert space, there should be four energy eigenstates in total. Now, the conventional textbook description, is in terms of two so-called Bogoliubov quasi-particles, which are created by an operator, which is a quantum superposition of an operator which creates a particle in state k up and one which destroys it in the state minus k down for this one, and in some sense vice versa for this one. So there'll be you have the ground state, you have the two so-called broken pair states. I'll come back to the name in a moment. The broken pair states, which are created by these two Bogoliubov operators, and then you can in fact apply both of these, and you get a fourth state, as we'll see. That's four states in total. But actually, as I say, this is the standard textbook way of doing things. You simply work in terms of these so-called Bogoliubov quasi-particle creation operators. However, in some sense, that obscures an important distinction. Let's suppose that we stay in the manifold of completely paired states, so that we still have this expression here. However, the UKs and VKs, or the CKs, whichever way we're doing it, don't necessarily have their ground state values. If this is so, we can still describe, since we're still within the manifold of completely paired states, we can still describe this in the language of Anderson pseudospins, but the spins are not necessarily in their ground state. Now, the most obvious excited state that you can produce is simply to take one spin, that is a spin corresponding to a particular pair, k up minus k down, and simply turn it around. Originally it was pointing along the effective field acting on it, now it's going to be pointing in the opposite direction. So in other words, let's just illustrate that very crudely. Your Anderson, in the ground state, your Anderson pseudo spins might look something like this, sorry, where crudely speaking, here's your Fermi surface here. And an excited state might be formed by simply, say, taking this guy and turning it around, like so. And intuitively, that should still be an energy eigenstate, but of course it's an excited eigenstate. So let's actually work out explicitly what this is. It's an excited pair state of the many-body system. What energy does it have? Well, you remember that the total field, as it were, which a spin sees in the Anderson pseudo-spin representation, is given by the formula. You remember, you have a field along the z-axis, which is ek, a field along the x-axis, which is delta k. So the total field is given by Pythagoras, it's just ek equal to square root of ek squared plus delta k squared. So that's the energy that the spin has. It has the energy minus this when it's in its ground state. When you turn it around, it has plus this. In other words, so the energy of your excited state then is simply twice ek. If you actually work out explicitly what the expression for the excited pair state is by looking at how the Anderson pseudo spin representation relates to the UKs and VKs, you find it's given by this expression here. I don't know if you can read it. Minus V star K 0 0 plus U star K 1 1. And that state is actually orthogonal to the ground state value. In the particle conserving language, you simply replace CK by minus C star K to the minus 1. That's equivalent to doing that. Okay. Now, all this sounds very terribly trivial, I realise, but there's a reason why I'm going through this in such minute detail. Just a few notes. Now, it's very important to realise that this transformation from the ground pair state to the excited pair state is actually number parity conserving. So in fact, in the particle conserving approach, it preserves the total number of particles. In the BCS approach, it preserves the parity. That is, if you start off with a superposition of even parity states, you stay in it. There's a slightly delicate technical point. Remember that in the particle conserving approach, you have to impose the condition that the total number of particles is given by this sum of k's, sort of effective normalization condition. So, since generally speaking, you will have changed the ck for one particular value of k, you're going to have to adjust all the other ck's just to make up for that. But essentially that's a 1 over n effect. Each one of the other ck's only adjusts by something of the order of 1 over n. So generally speaking, we think we can forget about it, but we are going to have to be a little careful later with that. If you use the BCS approach, then since you don't have this condition to worry about, you basically don't have to do anything. In the excited pair state, you see that in the Anderson pseudospin representation, you've simply turned the spin around. So what that means, if you just work it out in terms of nk's and so forth, is that nk is transformed to 1 minus nk. And importantly, the quantity fk, f sub k, goes to minus fk, f sub k. Now, in the special case, actually this should really come here rather than here. In the special case where uk is equal to vk, which is the case, will be the case if you're exactly at the Fermi surface, then, in fact, no adjustment of the other CKs turns out to be necessary. Finally, this is just worth noting that in the very special case where the total excitation energy, or in the Anderson pseudo-spin language, the total field acting on the particle is zero, that's not a very unusual case, but it might occur even within for relatively simple systems. For example, if I have a D-wave superconductor, it'll have a node in its energy gap. That is a point where the energy gap goes to zero. And if I'm then sitting on the Fermi surface exactly at that point, then my total energy is zero. So in that very special case, then any combination of 0, 0 and 1, 1 is an energy eigenstate. That's something we're going to have to come back to later in the context of Majorana fermions.
Sorry,
yeah.
Question.
Yeah, please.
We've gone to four different slides now.
Excuse me?
We have gone to four different slides right now.
Oh, yes.
Just trying to get some notations consistency from your 2014 lecture notes where you use alpha k as the
In fact, I will come. I mentioned the alpha k's, and I'll be coming back to them in a moment. But let's just go back for a moment. Incidentally, I wouldn't frankly advise you to try to necessarily find consistency with the 2014 notes, because I have changed some things. I think this particular thing is probably the same. Here are our alphas. So far we've entirely stayed, at least for the last two slides, we've entirely stayed within the even number parity sector. Now, let's turn to the odd number parity manifold. The simplest odd parity states are associated with a single pair, k up and minus k down. In other words, in the BCS method, our many body wave function is still a product over the pairs of states, k up and minus k down. And for all k's except the special one, the wave function is just going to be the same as it was in the ground state. We haven't changed anything. However, phi sub k is going to be different from its ground state value. Recapping, the Hilbert space is four-dimensional. We've used up the submanifold consisting of 0, 0 and 1, 1 for the even parity states. So the remaining states have to be the so-called broken pair states. And these are states in which, for example, k up is occupied, minus k down is empty, or vice versa. Now, the question is, how do we go about creating, for example, the state 1-0, the broken pair state 1-0, from the ground state? In other words, formally, what is the appropriate creation operator for it? This is actually supposed to be an alpha here, I think. It doesn't matter too much, but this should strictly be an alpha. Okay, well, we have several suggestions. One possibility is just to operate with the creation operator A dagger K up, and then we normalize. If we just operate with A dagger K up, of course, what we're going to do is get is the following. We start off, this is the ground state here, operating with this will give us a non-zero result from this part, but not from this part. Since this is already, both states are already occupied, then applying a creation operator is just going to give us zero. Okay? So if we do that, what we get out is this here, but then that's not normalized. So to normalize it, we've got to do this. We've got to divide by this factor. But this will be, at least at first sight, this will be a perfectly good, decent way of creating the state 0, 1. However, there's an alternative. We can operate with an annihilation operator, A minus K down, we normalize. In that case, we get nothing from this state 0, 0 here, because it's impossible to annihilate a particle from there. We do get a contribution from here, we get that. Therefore, apart from an overall sign, our alpha k would be this. The third suggestion is to combine these two operations, in other words, to write this formula here. And you notice there's something rather odd about this expression here, namely, this does not conserve the total number of particles here. That's a crucial point which we'll have to come back to several times. If we evaluate, in evaluating the result of doing this, one thing we've got to remember is that we do have to set up a convention for 1-1 relative to 0-0. It matters, or at least we've got to keep it consistent, whether we're defining 1-1 as this, or rather as this. In other words, it matters which way around we put these two operators, because the Fermi operator is anti-commute. Okay, so we've got to, we can do it either way, but we've got to keep that straight, and I'll try to keep it straight. So now, if we do use the anti-commutation relations of the fermionic operators, that will give us that alpha dagger k up, acting on the ground state, is this. That multiplying that out using the anti-commutation relations here, we find lambda k uk minus mu k vk times 1-0. Well, that's nice, because now if we know that this is the constraint on UK and VK, and so if we make this particular choice, this state is automatically normalized. And so so what we find now, again, it's all terribly well-known textbook stuff, but let's just go through it. What we find is the standard textbook formula for the Bogoliubov quasi-particle creation operator, alpha dagger k up is uk a k up minus v star k a minus k down. Then a similar argument gives the creation operator for the state 0, 1. That's this, and you notice the sign is different here. And the reason for that is basically this business of having to get the order of the A dagger K up and A dagger minus K down, right? Now, one more amusing thing is that if we do, in fact, consider the successive application of these two standard Bogoliubov operators, then what we actually find is, again, just takes a trivial bit of algebra to work this out, we find this result, but this result, you might remember, is precisely the excited pair state. So applying both your Bogoliubov quasi-particle creation operators gives you the excited pair state. Now, a question which might conceivably bother you, doesn't bother most people because I think they just swallow it when the textbooks say you should do this, but why should we choose method 3 rather than 1 or 2? And in fact, for the creation of single quasi-particles, it actually doesn't matter which of these things we do, and that's basically because there are no physical operators which change number parity. So in some sense, the definition of single quasi-particles relative to the ground state, you could say, is somewhat arbitrary anyway. However, let's consider a state in which we actually created two Bogoliubov quasi-particles from the ground state. So in different, let's say with both up, but different states k and k prime. You can actually do this in two different ways. You can create two. You can create two real particles. These are A's, not alphas. You create two real particles on the ground state, and that will give you a matrix element UK UK prime. Or you can destroy two particles, minus k down, we're down actually, minus k down and minus k prime down in the ground state, and that will give you, apart from a possible phase factor, vk times vk prime. Now the point is that you've gone now from a possible state to another possible state, and you can do it in two different ways. And as you all know, in quantum mechanics, if you can do something, you can get from A to B by two different paths, as it were, then you have to add the amplitudes for those paths before you square up to get probabilities. These processes are mutually coherent. And this is what would be lost if you use methods 1 or 2. Okay? So although, as I say, for single quasi-particles, 1 and 2 are perfectly decent ways of doing things, if you come to anything more complicated, you really shouldn't use them. You should use the standard textbook method. Okay, very briefly, we don't need to go into this in great detail, but what about the energy of the broken pair states? Well, this is actually slightly trickier than you might infer from some of the textbook presentations. You have to be rather careful in doing your energy accounting, for example, it's done in this chapter of my textbook. When you've done the energy accounting properly, then the increase of the kinetic energy in the broken pair states relative to the ground pair is given by this expression. And now, remember that the quantity fk, which is the anomalous amplitude in the BCS method, it's a dagger k up, a dagger minus k down. Since you've only got one state occupied, that quantity is automatically zero. So you've lost the pairing, the energy which was associated with their state. And as I say, you've got to watch the factors of two here to avoid overcounting. But it turns out that the increase of pairing energy is in fact delta squared over Ek. And therefore, the total energy of the broken pair state relative to the ground state is given by this, which comes out to be the standard expression for the energy of Bogoliubov quasi-particles. A couple of notes. First of all, the minimum value of Ek. Now, we have to be just a little careful here. Remember that epsilon k is not in fact the absolute value of the kinetic energy, it's the value relative to the chemical potential. provided the chemical potential is positive, which is the case in the sort of traditional BCS applications at least, then the minimum value of epsilon k is zero, and therefore the minimum value of capital EK, the quasi-particle excitation energy, is delta. And of course that's the name, reason for the name, the energy gap. Secondly, the difference between the excited pair state energy of the ground state pair is twice EK, which is twice the excitation energy of single quasar particles, and therefore that makes it in some sense the more tempting to regard the excited pair state as simply two volume of quasar particles. But I will come back to the point that I think in some contexts this can be very misleading, and we really should separate out the excited pair state, which is a modification of the Cooper pair wave function, from the broken pair states, which is something rather different. Okay, so far, as I say, all this is really pretty standard textbook stuff, but there is a reason why I'm going through it in this rather slow way, because some of these things are going to become rather important later. Okay.
Just a quick question.
I'm sorry?
Maybe one of them is BP instead of EP?
I'm sorry, one of what?
Yeah, so it's just energy EP minus energy GP, so the left.
EP, this I hope is an E, yeah, E. This is the energy of the excited pair minus that of the ground pair.
Yeah, so then this equals 2 times.
Something gone wrong here. This should be EBP minus EGP. Yeah, thanks for pointing that out. Yep.
So what is the EGP?
Sorry?
EBP minus EGP.
Yeah. So I mean, in words, the energy of the excited pair state is twice the excitation. The excitation energy from the ground state of the excited pair state is twice the excitation energy of one of the broken pair states. Okay. Now we come to another point, which seems rather trivial, but in fact will play a role later. Our Buchleboff creation operators have actually used two combinations of the four operators, a dagger k up, a minus k down, a dagger minus k up, down, a k up. There's a four operators. And those Buchleboff operators generate the broken pair states. However, out of these four operators, we can actually generate two other linearly independent orthogonal combinations, and these are, let's call these betas for the moment. These are given by these expressions here, and what happens if we apply these to the BCS ground state? Well, we'll get this expression here. Doing a bit of algebra gives us this minus this, well, that's identically zero. Similarly for beta k2. So these operators are what I call pure annihilators. If you apply these operators to the BCS ground state, you simply generate a state vector which has zero norm. In other words, physically this really doesn't correspond to any doable operation, I suppose, but formally you simply get zero here. Now at first you see, well, okay, what's the big deal? What in fact turns out is since beta k is just the Hermitian conjugate of so beta k up is the Hermitian conjugate of the Bogoliubov creation operator for minus k down. Now, we all sort of take it for granted that the Hermitian conjugate of the Bogoliubov creation operators, if you like the Bogoliubov destruction operator, automatically annihilates the ground state. Right? So that doesn't appear to be particularly surprising or significant. Again, there's a reason I emphasize it. Okay. So let's just summarize what we've done. As I say, this is all very, very standard textbook stuff. In the simple BCS theory, the simplest many-body energy eigenstates can be expressed in the form of a tensor product of occupation states phi k, referring to the pair of plane wave states k up minus k down. The even number parity ground pair state is this. The second completely paired even number parity state orthogonal to that, that's the excited pair state, which can be generated by successive application of the two Bogoliubov creation operators. Okay, so far. As I say, all of this is very, very standard stuff. Nevertheless, we need to go over it. Okay, now I think at this point we must get onto something just slightly less trivial. Okay, sorry, well, just to finish off that last bit, yeah, the odd number parity eigenstates are just these two states, 1, 0 and 0, 1. And these operators annihilate the ground state. Just one point to emphasize before we go on. It's entirely clear that my Bogoliubov creation operators, when applied individually, do not conserve particle number. That is, they are a quantum superposition of the creation of an extra particle and the destruction of a particle. So that's something which is going to be very fundamental later, so I just want to emphasize that. And all of this does generalize straightforward to the anisotropic case, including the P plus IP state, which we looked at earlier. And all you have to do is to remember to keep the spin suffixes straight and so forth, but nothing much changes. Okay, so far so good. What now if our Hamiltonian is more general? We've been dealing so far with the simple BCS case in which the Hamiltonian just consists of the kinetic energy and a two-particle potential energy, which is translation invariant. Therefore, we can apply all sorts of simple invariance principles. What happens if we have something a bit more general? We still have a kinetic energy, which looks like this. We might have, for example, a single particle external potential energy, which might or might not depend on the spins. And then we might have a rather general form of the inter-fermion potential energy. And the question is, how do we generalize the ideas of BCS to deal with this more general situation? Well, we still use our general definition of a completely paired even particle number state. So just as in the simple BCS case, we're going to write our many-body wave function as some normalization factor, which I generally won't write out explicitly, an anti-symmetrization operator, multiplying this sort of diatomic molecule-like structure here. You have a phi, a two-particle wave function for particles 1 and 2, two-particle wave function for 3 and 4, which is the same here. So you have your many-body wave function is a product of these two-particle wave functions, referring to pairs of particles, but of course it does have to be correctly anti-symmetrized. Now that comes out, that beast comes out a little more simply in second quantized language. It comes out as this expression here. Again, with some normalization. Normalizations in this game are always a real pain, and I'll try to not have to do them more than necessary, but you must remember they're there. Now, there's an important theorem. Given that structure, we can always give, in other words, given a molecular wave function or pseudo-molecular wave function which is anti-symmetric with respect to your variables here, you can always find a complete orthonormal set such that you can write it in this rather simpler form here. So in other words, you start off with a, let's say you you take your original wave function, express it in a in terms of some set of states, for example your plane wave states, okay? And in general you're going to have some rather horrible matrix. So it's got a rather large matrix with elements all over the place. However, this matrix is going to be is going to be fully anti-symmetric, right? Now, the theorem then says that you can always redefine your basis so that you what you've got is something which has zeros all down the diagonal here. And then say alpha one, alpha two, alpha three, dot 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 dot. Actually, I should call these C's, shouldn't I? So C1, C2, C3, etc. Everything else zero. Okay. In other, in other words, you can, as it were, skew diagonalize it, this matrix. Now, does anyone know whether that theorem has a name in mathematics? Someone must have proved this way back in the early 19th century, I imagine. But if you want a relatively simple, and as it were, physics-based proof of that, it's given in Yang's famous review article, one of the lemmas. Anyway, that's a crucial theorem. It now assures us that we can, for any completely paired state, again, emphasize, not the ground state necessarily, but any completely paired state, you can always write it in this rather more simpler form here. And I hope you can read this. This is supposed to be an M-twiddle. And M-twiddle, then, is, as it were, the partner state of M, but it's not the same as M here. I hope that that twiddle will be readable subsequently. Now, as long as we deal only with the even number parity states, we can continue exactly the analogy with the original BCS treatment, or the treatment that as I've given it. In other words, we can write the ground pair state in the following form in terms of some UM and VM, where we, instead of referring to states to plane wave states, k up and minus k down, now I'm referring to pairs of states, m and m twiddle. But apart from that, everything goes through. And in particular, the excited pair state is given by this expression here. So if all we ever had to deal with were these completely paired states, then we could stop at this point, basically. We wouldn't have to do anything further. Now, of course, we'd still have to ask ourselves how we find these, and that as we'll see in a moment, is actually not a totally trivial matter. This is continued from the last slide. The excited pair state is an energy eigenstate if the ground state was. Since you've just got this transformation here, and again, you can, as long as you're only dealing with these completely paired states, you can perfectly well afford to use the Anderson pseudo spin representation. You just turn a spin around, basically, to get the excited pair state. Now, however, life does become a little more tricky when we have to actually try to find explicitly what the parameters C, M, and what the states M and M truly are. In the BCS case, life was straightforward because we could assume, on, essentially on grounds of symmetry, that the plane waves, the states we're talking about, which are paired, are simple plane wave states. Right? Now we don't know that. We've got something much more complicated. So how are we going to find, the first of all, the states m and m twiddle, and secondly, the coefficients cm, which multiply them? Well, in the BCS case, we did this by writing down the expectation value of the Hamiltonian and just minimizing the sum of the single particle and pairing terms. And the question is, can we do the same here? Well, in principle, yes, we can. Suppose that we actually write a capital UM of R to be this expression here, capital VM of R to be that, and minimize the single pairing, single particle and the pairing terms, the sum of those, with respect to these functions subject to the orthogonality constraints. What do we get? Well, what we'll actually get, it turns out, I think this is probably not a sort of widely known fact, but what we actually do get as a result of this process looks exactly like the standard Bogoliubov-Degen equations, which we're going to derive in a moment. Right? But there's a crucial difference. The orthogonality constraints on this operation are much stronger than the ones in the standard BDG technique. And therefore, although in principle we know that a solution must exist, it's extremely difficult and complicated to find it, much more complicated than the method we're going to be using in a minute. In a very few special cases, we can actually do it explicitly. We already discussed the case where we knew that we could choose M twiddle to be the time reverse of M. That's a case in which we can actually do that operation, but in general we can't. Okay? So we have to do something else. Let me just go back a moment. We don't yet know how to deal with this problem, but let's perhaps slightly illogically, as it were, let's at this point switch from considering the even number parity state and think about the odd parity sector. This is a roundabout way of getting where we want to go eventually. Okay, so let's go to the odd number parity states. By exact analogy with the BCS case, you can always define these operators here, which will annihilate the ground state identically. Now, an important note, sort of sounds trivial, but again important, any linear combination of pure annihilators is itself a pure annihilator. Right? Also, these operators here, that is the analogues of the Bogoliubov quasi-particle operators, create the states 1,0 and 0,1, where 1 simply means that 1,0 simply means that M is occupied, M twiddle is empty, and the combination of these two generate the excited pair states phi EP. However, crucial difference now from BCS. These the states that we've created here are indeed good odd number parity eigenstates. They are eigenstates of the number parity corresponding to an odd value. However, in general, they're not energy eigenstates. And you can actually see that right away, because if, for example, you write out the single particle term, the kinetic plus potential energy term, then in general, it's not going to be diagonal in this basis. In the rare case when it is diagonal, then you're home free. So you know how to do that problem. But in general, they're not. So the odd parity states have to be linear combinations of these states 1,0m and 0,1m. In other words, they've got to be, it's got to be possible to write them in this form. And I'm sorry, there's actually something left out here, because in fact these have to be combinations of the alphas, which do have annihilation operators as well in them. So I'm sorry, this is just a mistake here. This would be something else put in. Now, question, how do we find these linear combinations? Well, what we should do is to write down the effective Hamiltonian, that is the value of the kinetic energy and the potential energy, factorize it as we would in BCS, and minimize the result. It actually turns out, so we could do this in the original representation, but it actually turns out to, in some sense, skip a step here and just go direct to the factorization of this operator in coordinate space here. So, in other words, I think something's gone wrong here. Do I want this here? What should be happening here is that I write this expression here, which involves four operators. I write that as an expectation value of two of those operators times the rest. So I think this is important enough that I should just write it out. I'm sorry that didn't come out quite right. So let me do that. So what I should have written here is psi star alpha of r, psi star beta of r prime, psi gamma of r prime, psi delta of r. I probably put my suffix is the same as there. It's not significant, but let's try to keep them right. So these are all operators here. So I put hats on them to indicate that. Okay, so that's an operator expression. What I'm now going to do is to factorize that by taking this expression here and taking its expectation value and leaving the rest as an operator. Right? And then I'll do the same the other way around. So I'll also consider the possibility that I have an operator here.
Yes,
and now I'm going to do the other way around. For consistency, I'm going to also have to regard these two as operators, r prime, and then take the expectation value of these two here. So that's a sort of typical mean field decoupling, with the important difference, of course, that the quantities whose average I've taken here are not number conserving. They are these anomalous averages, which are only strictly speaking defined in the BCS method when you've got a superposition of different particle number states. Once we've made that approximation, which is crudely speaking, that this is the analog of simply keeping the BCS terms in the pairing terms in the original Hamiltonian in the BCS method. So once I've done that, it's convenient to define this quantity delta alpha beta of r and r prime. And then we find that the effective mean field Hamiltonian is now bilinear in psi and psi dagger, Okay, first of all, it's got the usual kinetic energy term, which is not much changed. That's, but now we've approximated the potential terms by this bilinear expression, where delta alpha beta is given self-consistently by this expression here. Okay, is that clear? Again, standard textbook stuff, but it's important to realize what we're doing here. We're making a particular assumption about the terms which are important in the potential energy expression. Again, we've forgotten, I've forgotten explicit here about the Hartree and Fock terms. We should really, in principle, put those in. They don't usually make a qualitative difference, but if we're going to do things completely, you should keep them. But these are usually regarded as the important terms. Okay, so now you've got yourself an effective Hamiltonian, which is bilinear in the psis and psi daggers, but does contain these anomalous terms here. So what's that going to mean for the energies? Well, we can now look for the creation operators of not just of the odd parity states, I mean we know how to do that, but the odd parity energy eigenstates, we can seek them in this form here. Again, these are linear combinations now. Because our Hamiltonian contained these anomalous terms, our creation operators now have to be linear combinations of a creation and an annihilation operator with the normalization constraint there. In other words, what we're going to do is create an extra particle, an extra real particle with a wave function u of r and an extra hole with wave function v of r. Again, emphasize, we're not conserving particle number here. We have a linear combination of an extra particle and an extra hole. Now, the standard way of approaching the problem of finding the gamma i's in the literature is to simply take the commutator of the mean field Hamiltonian with gamma I and require that it be equal to some excitation energy times gamma negative I. And that then gives you the Bogoliubov-Degen equations, which are now at least 50 years old, somewhat more than 50 years old, I think, at this point. In fact, actually, they were first formulated, if I recall, by Bogoliubov in the Bose case, some years before BCS, but it was Degen who really took them up and applied them to the BCS problem. The Bogoliubov-Degen equations are, in the most general case, they're rather complicated, because in addition to the particle hole degree of freedom, you've got to also deal with a spin degree of freedom. And so in the most general case, they're 4x4, and even when we have to deal with the B phase of superfluid helium 3, we are going to have to worry about that. But for most other cases, luckily we don't. For most other cases, we can treat the spin degree of freedom as it were, trivial. Either we have spin singlet pairing, in which case the spins are just up for U and down for V, or vice versa. Or alternatively, we're dealing with a spin triplet, but equal spin pairing, so we only have to worry about pairs like this and like this. So I will give the version for a single spin species, but I will keep the spatial non-locality. That's an important issue. With that single restriction, this is the form of the Bogoliubov-Degen equation, and you see they're basically 2x2. So you have essentially a 2x2 matrix here. So schematically, this is what we get. Yeah, In general, you have to remember that delta is an integral operator. In some special cases, for example, if you're dealing with an S-wave superconductor with a contact interaction, delta may just be some simple function of R, but in general, it's an integral operator. Now, an interesting point here, the U's by themselves don't form an orthonormal set in general. However, the spinners composed of U and V, if you regard those as the basic entities, they do form an orthonormal set. In other words, if I take there's a mistake here. This should be UI UJ plus. It should be UI UJ plus VI VJ is equal to delta IJ. Okay, in other words, regarded as single spinner wave functions, the different eigenfunctions are orthogonal. And that, you can actually prove that directly from the equations themselves. Now you notice that that's different from the problem we had earlier when we were trying to minimize the ground state energy directly. In that case, we had to choose the UIs individually to be orthogonal to one another, and similarly for the VIs, but now we only need the combination. So in our case now, the set of the gamma I's form a complete set of anti-commuting Fermi operators, and moreover, you can prove directly that when their complex conjugates operate on the ground state, that will simply annihilate the ground state. Now I come to a problem which I think is very, on the whole, rather badly discussed in the literature, and again, is very confusing, I think, if one doesn't understand what's going on. People often make the following observation in the literature. If the spinner UI with the components UI and VI solves the Bogoliubov-Dejean equations with an energy eigenvalue capital EI, then it follows quite directly, you can just do this by going through the substitutions, that the spinner whose components are minus V star I and U star I will solve the equations with eigenvalue minus E sub I. And there's all sorts of talk in the literature about this, how this combination then is creating a negative energy state and words to that effect, which I think is actually unnecessarily confusing, because what the situation really is, is that there is an operator, again, a twiddle I, which corresponds to this spinner. It's not, in general, simply the Hermitian conjugate of one of the gamma I's, but it is a linear combination of them. This should be referring to the original, in the original representation, remember our completely paired representation, there are these pure annihilation operators. So it shouldn't really have a dagger on it, I guess. But anyway, it's a linear combination of those operators, and since those are pure annihilators, it's itself a pure annihilator. Another way of putting this point is that what you've required is that this equation is satisfied here. However, when you said that the gamma twiddle I creates an eigenstate of an energy eigenstate, well, what you're really saying is that this equation is satisfied. However, that equation is trivially satisfied if you simply annihilate the ground state. So these so-called negative energy states really simply correspond to the operators which annihilate the ground state. They're nothing more complicated than fancy than that. And I think it's very misleading and confusing to think of them as negative energy states. Notice that the pair wave function is given by this equation here. Therefore, the gap equation is given by this relation here. For a contact potential, which people often discuss, and spin singlet pairing, I mean, for a spin triplet, of course, the contact potential gives you nothing because the particles never get together. But for spin singlet pairing, you may get something. Then in fact, your gap function comes out to be this expression here. Now, now at this point, let's just go back to our original problem. You remember that I formulated the original many-body wave function in this m twiddle basis. But then we had to, as it were, wander away from that, and the solutions of the Bogoliubov-Dejean equations don't seem to have any direct relationship to that basis. So, the question is, what's the relation between the functions m and m twiddle and the coefficient, and also the coefficient cm occurring in that expression for the even parity ground state, and the u's and v's which occur in the solution to the Bogoliubov-Dejean equations? And it actually turns out that's a rather messy problem. And as far as I know, it hadn't been explicitly, and it's not surprising, I mean, after all, the Bogoliubov-Dejean equations have been around now for more than 50 years, and you might think that someone would worry about this. But apparently no one did really, until my colleague Mike Stone at the University of Illinois and his student, Sir Wong Chung, wrote this paper in 2006. The paper was mostly about operations you do with Majorana fermions and so forth, but they have an appendix on this particular point. And they got, as it were, a partial conclusion to this this question in the following sense. Suppose that we know the transformation between the m and m twiddle and the normalized u's and v's, which it's convenient to write in the following form. Let's write the creation operator for the real Bogoliubov quasiparticle, that is the energy, the odd parity energy eigenstate, gamma I. Let's write that formally as a linear combination of the A daggers and A's, where the sum, however, now runs over both the M's and the M twiddles. Then, if you provided that you can assume that this transformation is invertible, then it turns out that the relation between the CMs and the U's and V's is the matrix generalization of that. Namely, that CM is this matrix operator acting on this element of the matrix product V times U to the minus 1, where U and V are this matrix here. In other words, it's this expression here. So, so if you know the expression for the M and M twiddle in terms of the UIs and VIs, that is in terms of the gamma I which occurs in the Bogoliubov-Dejean equations, then you can find the expression for CM. However, that doesn't really give us much intuition or help in actually finding the explicit forms of the matrices U and V. And that is actually still a very nasty problem. We'll run up against it when we deal, actually this will be in lecture 6, with the Kataev quantum wire, which is an exactly soluble model where one can see some of these things coming out exactly. But so at the end of the day, we found something rather peculiar, and this is something which has sort of always worried me a little in some sense. The Bogoliubov-Degen equations really tell us almost nothing, or nothing directly at least, about the even parity energy eigenfunctions themselves, which, remember, were most easily expressed in this MM twiddle basis. They don't even tell us much about the odd parity eigenfunctions themselves. What the Bogoliubov-Degen equations are telling us is really about the relation between the even and odd parity eigenstates. That then brings up what I think is a very important question. Does the existence of a constant set of solutions, does the existence of a consistent set of solutions to the Bogoliubov-Degen equations guarantee us that the even parity and odd parity states, which these equations are supposed to relate, actually exist? That's not obvious. The question is can we, in some sense, provide a constructive proof that they do exist? And it turns out, I don't think, as far as I know, this isn't stated anywhere in the literature. It's certainly not in the Stone-Chung paper that I mentioned earlier. I believe the answer is yes, if we can actually calculate this this order parameter, which, remember, is given. Now, that's given in the Bogoliubov-Degen method by this expression here. But it's all it is the expectation value of psi dagger r prime. That's what we mean by f of r and r prime. Now you notice that that must be true, as it were, in any possible representation, including the original canonical one that we use for the even parity ground state. So if we can actually diagonalize this beast, that is, if we can find the unique representation in which this is given by sum over m u m v star m phi m of r phi m twiddle of r r prime, if we can actually perform that operation, find the eigenvalues and eigenfunctions of corresponding to f, then we're home. Then we can actually write down explicitly what the original canonical representation of the even parity ground state is. I've only realized that actually quite recently, and I think what is rather interesting is to try to do that operation explicitly for certain problems like the Kitaev quantum wire problem, which we'll come to in a couple of lectures' time, and see if in fact it does provide an explicit way of finding the ground state wave function. Because you see, I think it's highly, it's highly non-trivial. The mere fact that everyone always assumes in the literature, I think without exception, that if you can write down a set of Bogoliubov-Degen equations and solve them, then that guarantees that there must be a ground state wave function and excited state wave functions which correspond to this. That, as I say, that's not obvious at all. So I think it's a real problem whether we can, in any particular case, whether we can actually carry out this operation and demonstrate explicitly the form of the ground state wave function. It'll be, if it can be done, which is sort of doubtful, but if it can be done for the really interesting cases we're going to get onto in the next lecture, where you have your quasi-particles, your Bogoliubov quasi-particles actually in some sense correspond or have some relation to Majorana fermions, then I think that will be extremely important. Whether it can be done, I don't know, but we'll see.